All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sport Chat 503. Man, oh man, it's been a while. Thank you guys for watching. First time, long time. Either way, you know I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon. It is live and direct. It's about 95 degrees out here. It is Thursday, July 26th. We just had our media day, and this is usually when I get this thing started. First and foremost, I'd like to thank everybody out there. If you guys have been watching the show for a while and rolling with it, this is its ninth year. Started in the 09-10 season, and I'm pretty proud of this little run we've got going. Shouts out to my man, Bo. Used to be in the studio with me about the first 6-7 years, and now he's moved since to Idaho. Now I'm on solo ride. Let's get this thing rolling. Again, people, I try to come at you from a couple different angles. I try to give you a duck perspective. Again, I'm not the end-all, be-all here. I'm just a guy in my basement in Southeast Portland, but I am generational duck fan. I've been to Oregon my whole life. I'm born on campus and a season ticket holder. I'm right next to the stadium. I'm right next to the field. Get good shots during the games. Try to give you some game footage, and then we talk in the studio each week. This video is about the Ducks, man. We're going to talk about this season. We're going to talk about the roster a little bit and talk a little about what we heard at Media Day yesterday with Cristobal and all the like, man. So let's go ahead and get into this thing. First and foremost, let's talk about the schedule, okay? We've known the schedule for a while. I talked with another YouTuber, Mark Rogers. He does a little thing called Mark Rogers TV, but he does a little college football thing, a more East Coast perspective, a lot of Miami guys, and they love Cristobal. But I like to think about the schedule. One of the things that they were really hitting on, and then what I've seen in the national perspective so far, is how soft Oregon's schedule is. So going into it, we know we got 3 weeks in a row of just straight hamburger, and it's a tough one. It sucks that other teams have backed out in the past, leaving this window of non-opportunity or opportunity. There's kind of two different ways to look at this. I think college football fans are kind of split down the middle as long as the system is the way it's set up right now. I think most college football fans would love, if they go to the games or if they are passionate about watching the games, would rather see better games. They'd rather see, like in the last couple years, we played Nebraska, or to start the year off with a Mississippi State or somebody from the Big 10 or SEC. The year we played Auburn or LSU to start the year. You know, those are the kind of things I think football fans are really excited about. There's another group that says, why would you even try to play a competitive schedule when you just want to get wins at the end of the season? At the end of the year, you want to have as many wins as possible. So there's kind of two different schools there. I tend to think you want to play better teams, but I get playing a softer schedule and just stacking up wins. These three are going to be fairly boring games. It should be beautiful weather at Autzen, so it's always a good way to go. Good reason to go down there, but I mean, starting the year off with Bowling Green, Portland State, and San Jose State is not great. And then starting the year with an absolute slaughterhouse, which is Stanford. So let's talk about the Pac-12 a little bit. Stanford is the first team, and it is a brutal one. You know, Stanford every year is awesome, and I have yet to figure out their real recipe other than just getting the best athletes they can from all across the country. They're one of the only teams that can recruit in every single high school. They have no boundaries. They take the best kids. They take the four-point students. I think Stanford, though, could be up against it this year a little bit. Of course, you got Bryce Love coming back. He's the main guy, Heisman Trophy candidate, and rightly so. I just don't know about the rest of their squad. I don't know about the quarterback situation as much. I don't know about their receivers, and I don't really know about their line. Their line is always the thing that kind of separates them from everybody else, and then they always have some super stud on the defensive end, or defensive line, defensive tackle position, that is just a monster. So that's one that I can't say at this point. Win or loss, I don't know. I'll have to feel that game out. I think it's going to be close. Playing at Autzen is going to help, hopefully. But it's really just about how Oregon's playing at that point. At Cal is a really good road game. I think you can win at Cal. Cal's kind of on their way up. I think they will kind of get back to somewhat of prominence, but I think they're still the fifth, sixth worst team in the Pac-12 North. It's them and Wazoo, I think, really are battling. Then Oregon has a bye. So let's say even if they lose to Stanford, beat Cal, You're still 1-1 in the conference. You have a bye. The bye comes a little early in the year, which is a little strange. Lately, it's come later in the year, but this one comes at a perfect time right before UW. The UW game is going to be huge. I think having it home is an advantage, but this is a team that's been playing really well as of late, and you know, it's going to be a question what they're going to do when they you're going to have a lot of players start to leave there, and you already have. You've seen guys go to the NFL. It's going to be interesting to see how they continue this. They've had a great window. They had a great team these last couple years. It'll be interesting to see, can they stay at that level? That's what Oregon had trouble doing. So I do think that Wazoo, University of Washington, I should say, I do think the Huskies are going to be difficult, and I think they could win this game very easily, and I think they probably will win this game if you look it on paper. But Oregon's, I think, got a team that could really throw a wrinkle in it. So if Oregon's clicking, they could beat Stanford, they could beat Washington. The at Washington State game is a real question mark to me. I hate playing up in Pullman. Pullman is a weird place. I was watching the Media Day coverage with Chip Kelly, and he talked about if you don't know what you're doing in this conference, you're going to go to Pullman, you're going to lose, which is exactly what happens. Pullman's an interesting place. Mike Leach, really, really devastating quarterback suicide this year, leaving them in a difficult place. With the quarterback position, I don't really know what's going to be there. They usually always have good wide receivers. They usually always have pretty good running backs. Their running game has been great as of late. But that's going to be an interesting one. I feel like they're trending downward, and I feel like Oregon's trending upward, so I kind of like Oregon's odds on that one. At Arizona, Arizona's always a tough place to play. It's rowdy. One of the rowdiest places in the Pac-12. Usually you got to play it at night because it's so hot there. It gets the fans all day to get lubed up and just get absolutely insane. They've done weird stuff there. We've gone into triple overtime there. We have just incredibly wild games there. So I think anything goes in Arizona. It's a real question mark. I like it as a win. Khalil Tate, again, great year last year. Got a whole new thing in here now with Kevin Sumlin. Brand new coaching staff. You have no idea what you're going to expect there. There should be a little bit of frustration, I feel like, with this team. I don't think they're going to have the year like they had last year, in the middle of the year, especially when they were just clicking off those wins. UCLA at home, boy, Chip. You know, I got a lot of love for Chip. I'm not a guy who wants to spend time hating on any stretch, but, you know, leaving for the NFL, did what he did. I really didn't see him coming back to the Pac-12, but you know what? Bam, welcome, you know. I don't think UCLA is that big of a threat. I think they're trending downward. I think the players will love having Chip instead of Jim Mora. Jim Mora did not impress me at all. But I do think Chip's going to have an uphill climb. I think he's in the shadow of USC. I think UCLA has always been in the shadow of USC. I think it's really tough to win in that town. Recruiting-wise, I think they get really good players, but I don't know why they can't produce really good talent on the way out, or why they can't produce wins when they get that talent. So I think it's going to be an interesting one. I don't think he's going to run the spread exclusively. I think he's going to do a lot of different stuff. Then we get, Utah. Okay, at Utah is probably, in my mind, probably one of the harder games this year outside of Stanford and Washington. Stanford and Washington are the best two teams of the conference. So they should, in my mind, they're the best two teams. They should be a problem. But going to Utah is difficult. Rice-Eccles Stadium, oh man, it's a wild one over there. Major question mark to me. Major question mark. I could see a loss there. We had to have a miracle play to save it a couple years ago with Carrington. So it could get really wild there this year. ASU on the road. I am not impressed with Herm Edwards. I just watched his press conference literally just minutes ago. I don't know what to expect there. ASU is the largest school in the nation. I have no idea why they can't be a dominant force. They're right in Tempe. It's right in the backyard of Phoenix. It's unbelievable down there. Scottsdale, the whole thing is there. I can't understand why they can't put it together all the time. Get them late in the year, coming up to our place in the rain, in the cold. I like our chances. Usually, Oregon beats ASU pretty handily late in the season up here. I feel like instead of going down there and doing these triple overtime things or double overtimes. And then we get the Beavs, man. Jonathan Smith returns. It's a fantastic situation. Lots of turnover this year in the Pac-12. Lots of turnover. You know, Jonathan Smith, one of the best quarterbacks Oregon State has had. Really great, great player. Had a great time. Chad Ochocinco was one of his wide receivers, for Christ's sake. You know, and the guy was just had a really unbelievable run. And so he saw success there. And I really want to believe that he thinks he can get it done there. I just don't see it happening. I think that Oregon State is in such a difficult place with the Pac-12 right now. Washington is so much better than they were 10 years ago. Washington State's so much better than they were 10 years ago. Oregon is as good or in the same realm 10 years ago as 2008. You know, it was right before this little meteoric run we had over the last 10 years. But Oregon's been pretty good, you know, the whole time. Stanford is a crusher. And then Cal feels like it's a little bit on the rise. So I don't know where Oregon State's going to go, just being realistic. So it's going to be interesting to see how that goes. I do think that him being an alumni, they're going to give him another couple years maybe extra than they'd give a normal guy if he just brought in some other guy. I do think they're furious about Gary Anderson, and I would be as well. That was just a terrible situation all the way around. There was nothing really positive about that at all. But, you know, in my mind, I think it's done is done. I see at the very best, I think you're seeing like 9-10 wins out of this team for the Ducks. And I think realistically, you're probably looking at like 7 or 8 wins. There's going to be times where I'm wrong, obviously. I'm no expert. I'm just giving my opinion here. But I've seen enough and I've kind of witnessed enough to kind of question a little bit what we're doing with the offense. Herbert's the man. Let's talk about Herbert for a second, okay? I think he's going to be really, really, really good. He went to Africa this summer. He's way stronger. He's much more just confident. You know, he came in. He's the first freshman to start since Chris Miller. I was in the building watching Chris Miller, having the women behind me yelling, "It's Miller time!" Chris Miller was the man, dude. Chris Miller was one of my favorite quarterbacks of all time, and I really thought that there were a lot of times when everybody's saying, who's the best quarterback at Oregon? And nobody even talks about Chris Miller. Guy was a really good NFL quarterback. Came at a time where there were a lot of really good NFL quarterbacks. And Chris Miller was a great one. Man, I'm telling you, coming in as a freshman and playing as a freshman and doing well as a freshman is unbelievable. Last year looked really good at times. And again, I don't know what you're going to get with this one, but I feel like this could be a really special year for Justin Herbert. I feel like if he stays healthy, everything comes together. You know, the Herbert collarbone last year was just a terrible situation, but he came back firing, you know? And I feel like that's really the thing to help him in the future, is that to know you're going to have bumps and bruises, you're going to have hurdles, you just got to jump over them and clear them. Tony Brooks James, man, let's talk about the running backs. This is a running back school, right? So I think Tony Brooks James is going to have a huge year. This is just a setup. You know, having Royce last year was a big deal. But you could have run Tony Brooks James a lot more than you did. You could have had a lot more action. I really like what's going on in the running back room. The other guy I think you really want to watch out for is CJ Verdell. They moved Taj Griffin down, and hopefully they're going to give Taj the ball. They had him at the wide receiver. They've moved him out of the wide receiver room. I think that the running back room is really healthy right now. I think the young guys coming up after that are even better. And there's been some guys who've left a little bit, but I think Tony Brooks James is going to have a phenomenal year. And then wide receiver, I think it's Dillon Mitchell is going to be the main man. I really liked what I saw out of Brendan Schooler last year. And I think he has the potential. Him and Herbert have been spending a lot of time together. Herbert's got the long hair, he says, because Schooler was an influence. I think Jalen Redd is going to play quite a bit. Daywood Davis, but this Tabari Hines, the grad transfer, I think he's going to start. He might get some real playing time. Johnny Johnson III, obviously, I think might be starting. And then I really, really think Jacob Breeland's going to have a huge year. The tight end position, I think, is pretty smoking right now at Oregon. I think Breeland's got this really nice little potential of being able to run after the catch, but being able to get open in space is the other thing. I think a lot of wide receivers or a lot of tight ends, when they run out and they become a wide receiver, they just get real clunky. Breeland really is smooth and he's pretty effortless. Defensively, man, I think it all starts in the middle. Jordan Scott, I think that guy is a tremendous, tremendous game changer, okay? He might not be the highlight reel every game, but if you know football and you know how to watch tape and you see especially line play, He does everything a linebacker would want a defensive tackle or a nose guard to do. He stands guys up at the line of scrimmage. He hand fights beautifully. He gets motion. He gets opens. He holds the hole open a little bit. I mean, the guy does everything you want. And the guy was coming off a true freshman. Hasn't really hit the weight room hard. Now he's got a full year on the weights. He looks a lot better. He looks a lot quicker, smoother. I think he's going to have a phenomenal year. I think you also have Jalen Jelks, the big guy off the end. Oregon, for whatever reason, has developed some really good defensive ends, and it starts way back in time, obviously. We don't need to go through all the whole history of it. But in the last couple, 5-10 years, they've got some really good ones, and they all kind of look a similar way. They're real tall, they're pretty strong, but they're super fast off the edge. And Jalen Jelks is that guy this year. I think he's going to put a lot of pressure on quarterbacks. I think the defense is going to be better than it was last year. And last year it was 100 times it felt like better than it was the year before. So, you know, if we went from like 130th to like 30th, what are you going to do this year to get better? And then the captain of the defense is Troy Dye. The guy is phenomenal. The guy is going to be one of the best players. I feel like he's a Kiko Alonso type player. He's got a fearless quality about him. He'll hit the hole as hard as he can. He'll rip through guys. And then he'll backtrack and get an interception at an absolute key crucial time. I really, really, really like Troy Dye. I think Lamar Winston's going to have a great year. A kid from Portland, we have a lot of success with him. Holland's another guy off the edge, or that outside backer, whatever you want to call it. I think they call it like the duck backer or whatever. And then you've got the guys in the corner, man. I was super impressed with the freshmen last year. Thomas Graham, Commodore Lenore. Man, Lenore, I think, had a great year, especially late in the year. I feel like he really kind of came on. Graham was the man since day one. Graham came in and looked the part since day one. So I really expect big things from them. I don't really know what we're going to get outside of that. I hope we're going to get some other guys to fill in. But I feel like that's one of the lightest positions on the team. And then you get those safeties. I feel like Nick Pickett's going to do a great job. Ugo Amadi, I feel like that's where you're going to really have that back end locked up. Brady Breeze went through a little procedure, he said, on Instagram or whatever, or Twitter or something. I don't know what his injury was. But he was kind of one of those that we were expecting some big things out of. And then, you know, you got your kicker. Adam Stack is a stud. I think Oregon's got some good stuff ahead of it. I really do like where we're at right now. I feel like Cristobal has really got the ball rolling. Again, every time I listen to that guy, every time I watch that guy, it makes me want to hit the weight room or do some push-ups or some sit-ups. The guy is just an absolute stud football coach. I feel like the guys underneath him are just powerhouse recruiters. They're getting really good players coming in. The fact that we got this kid just, yesterday, day before, the recruit from UCLA, that's a huge deal. And, you know, I think the situation there, you know, you just got to look at, hey, when Oregon was at its best, I feel like Oregon had speed, it had strength off the edge, and it made people miss defensively. It wasn't like the defense really shut anybody down. It wasn't like, you know, the offense was at times the best scoring offense, but it wasn't like a powerhouse offense. It wasn't like an offense that just run you over. You know, it was an offense that, you know, you had to kind of dink and dunk a little bit, and you kind of had to make people miss a little bit, and it kind of had to work for you. So I really think this year could be some more smash mouth football. You've brought in more of the pistol formation, which I think is really important. Not many people are going with the pistol right now. I think Oregon could revolutionize that a little bit with what we're doing right now. I feel like the weight room is a big game changer this year. Weight room is way bigger. I feel like the guys are much stronger, much more ready to go. So I feel like it's all systems go. I'm really impressed with what we're doing down there. Whole new procedure this year with the bag policy. We got the clear bags like we've had to do for the bowl games for the last 5 years. Now we got that at Autzen. No more backpacks, no more sleeping bags and all that sort of shit people brought in. You can still bring in your coats and your blankets and everything, but you can't bring in a bunch of stuff and hide all that shit. It's going to be wild, man. I feel like this year, those first couple three games, people are going to be kind of bored. You know, I think it's going to be, people are going to be really excited to see what you're going to look like against Stanford. If you can beat Stanford, god dang, man, this thing's going to get rolling. Okay, each week, I'll be hitting you. I've been at the beach this week. I'll be going back this weekend. I'm out of here, man. Manzanita Golf Course. If you want a nice little par three in the North Oregon coast, go check out. It's not a par three. They got par fours as well, but they're no par fives. It's a, I don't know what you call it. It's like a par 36 or something. Anyway, hey, man, have at it. Enjoy your day. Peace to everybody out there in the Pacific Northwest, around the world. Duck fans, unite. Let's have some fun times at Autzen Stadium this year watching some football. I'll be back each week. Ducks, Pac-12, national football, the whole thing. All right, guys.